A mother gives her 11-year-old son £1 for his bus fare, so that he can catch the bus to his father's house. His father's home was just 2 miles away, and a short hop on the bus. But the boy would never make it to his father's house. And the story of the 11-year-old's disappearance would never make the pages of a single mainstream national newspaper. Only the small corner sections of the third page of a local gazette and a small corner section of the seventh page of the Daily Mail, but only after he'd been found. This is the story of the brutal rape and murder of 11-year-old Wayne Taylor. Wayne Taylor, born on the 6th of December 1978 to Caroline Taylor and Cyril Ramsey. He was the second eldest of four. He had an older 16-year-old sister, a younger 8-year-old sister, and a younger 5-year-old brother. Wayne went to Drumminer boarding school in Iverheath, Buckinghamshire, where he came home to his mother Caroline's house every other weekend. Wayne had been a pupil at the boarding school for 2 years, which was a special primary school for emotionally and behaviourally challenged children. The school was run by the Inner London Education Authority and had approximately 40 pupils aged between 6 and 11 boarding at the school for 35 weeks out of the year. Wayne had been sent to the school after his classroom attitude and attainments had deteriorated, but at Drumminer he had begun to flourish. Head teacher Richard Ward described him as very friendly and trusting, with an acute sense of humour, and he really enjoyed the social life of school. He also said that Wayne was the largest boy in school and protected the other children, and he was also the most popular child and a leading light at the school. Deputy Head Hugh Harris described Wayne as the most popular boy with staff and pupils, who loved games and was a key member of the school football team. He also states that Wayne was an accomplished gymnast and had recently started canoeing. He said Wayne will surely be missed by all. Wayne was making good progress and had recently won an essay competition on Nelson Mandela. He was said to be a big Nelson Mandela fan. Wayne was described as being 5'1" and big for his age, and he also had the initials WT shaved into his head. On Monday the 19th of February 1990, it was the first day of the school half-term holiday, and Wayne decided to meet his best friend in Kennington, where they would go to Lambeth Walk shopping centre. He returned home to his mother's house that afternoon, where he asked his mum if he could go to his dad's house, saying, "You promised I could go see him." His mother relented, and at 3:30 p.m, she gave him £1 for his bus fare to his dad's house in Brixton. But Wayne's father wasn't in, so Wayne set off to look for him. At around 4 p.m, a young boy fitting Wayne's description was seen near Southwick House, also known as Barrier Block. Another person said that they remember seeing Wayne standing on the first floor landing of Southwick House at around 4 p.m. And also, at around 4:30 p.m, Wayne was then seen on Atlantic Road in Brixton, where he called into a Caribbean food shop he knew that his dad frequented and asked the worker there if he had seen his dad. But the shop worker told Wayne that his dad hadn't been in yet that day. At around 6 p.m. and 7 p.m, Wayne had gone back to the same grocery shop on two further occasions, asking again if anyone had seen his dad yet. But on both occasions, he was told by the shop worker that his dad wasn't there and they still hadn't seen him yet. Wayne was last seen at 7 p.m. on Atlantic Road in Brixton. After a few hours, Wayne's mum reported him missing to the police. Two days later, On Wednesday the 21st of February 1990, two police officers were doing a routine patrol on the Southwark estate and decided to look into a disused abandoned community centre that had been closed for 2 years. There they found the body of 11-year-old Wayne Taylor. One leg of his trousers was down and one shoe was off. He had bruising on his shoulders. He was found lying face down on an old mattress. He'd been brutally raped and someone had suffocated him by holding their hand over his mouth and nose until he stopped breathing. At 11 a.m. the next day, Wayne's father positively identified the body as that of his son Wayne. Wayne had been wearing a navy t-shirt, grey Joe Block jeans and red Reebok trainers, and those were the clothes he still had on when he was found. Although no mainstream newspaper covered the murder, it was mentioned on a local TV news station and a local radio station. Upon hearing of the murder, neighbours and a close friend of Wayne's mother, Caroline, went round to the house to comfort her. But Caroline hadn't been informed by the police that her son had been found and the horrific details of his murder. They had gone to the local reporters first. Caroline was said to be absolutely devastated about the death of her son and that the police hadn't bothered to inform her first before they told the media. The police's response was that unfortunate circumstances had led to his mother not being informed first. The only other media to report on the murder of Wayne Taylor was UK Crime Stoppers show Crime Watch, who ran a segment on Wayne's murder 4 months after his murder.
Our first appeal is the murder of a child.
The Murder Squad incident room in South London followed up on clues from the public and conducted thousands of interviews and took 250 statements, but got disappointing results. One exception was a vital new lead that came in of a similar attack on a 9-year-old boy in Brixton 8 months before Wayne's murder. On the 20th of June 1989, a 9-year-old boy had been playing football all day with his friends near to Southwick House in Brixton, the same estate where Wayne would be found murdered 8 months later. That evening, as the 9-year-old boy made his way home just before midnight along Brixton Hill, he was dragged down the back of an alley by a man who he described as small but strong and claiming that his name was Derek. The man pushed the 9-year-old boy between a car and a wall down the alleyway and removed one leg of his trousers and one shoe. He then subjected the 9-year-old boy to a serious sexual assault. The boy started screaming until the man choked him out in a chokehold and he passed out. The sex attacker left him for dead, but the boy's screams had alerted a nurse whose house looked out onto the alleyway and also a male passerby who came to the boy's aid. The attacker ran off and the passerbys called an ambulance, and the boy survived. Semen taken from the 9-year-old boy by forensic scientist Julie Allard was tested and compared to the semen taken from the body of Wayne Taylor. It was a match by 1 in 100 million, meaning that the same attacker had sexually assaulted both boys and had lightly killed Wayne. Police launched a massive hunt for the paedophilic sex attacker and issued an e-fit of the man they were looking for based on a description given to them by the 9-year-old. The man was described as being between 25 and 27 and about 5'4" tall, with a skinny build. He wore a t-shirt with a woodpecker on it, and he had short black curly hair with a thin moustache. Police warned parents in Brixton not to let their children out alone, especially after dark, with Police Chief Bill Haver warning that we are dealing with a very dangerous man. With the case slowing down and no suspects, the only other lead police had was a receipt found near Wayne's body for a trapper hat that had been brought in a shop on the Atlantic Road in Brixton, the last road that Wayne had been seen alive on. The hat had been brought on the day Wayne had gone missing. Understandably, Children around Brixton and those that went to Wayne School were frightened, fearing that they too could be snatched off the road at any minute. Police said that Wayne wasn't the type of child to go off with somebody he didn't know, so they wondered if someone Wayne had known, who had used the fact that Wayne had been walking up and down Atlantic Road looking for his dad, as an opportunity to say that they knew where his dad was, so follow them and they would lead Wayne to him. Police also theorised that Wayne had previously owned a trapper hat, but it had been stolen by two boys. So police wondered if the perpetrator had known this and offered to buy Wayne a trapper hat in order to befriend him, to lure him with them, and so it might explain the receipt for a trapper hat that was found near his body. Allegedly, a man who had been locked up in Brixton prison for a minor crime bragged to his cellmate about how he had raped and murdered a boy a few months earlier. The cellmate went to the police with the information that he had been told, and with the case cold and no other leads to go on, police arrested the man and took a DNA sample. The police also found a palm print at the scene of the crime and on a toilet door in the squat where Wayne's body was found, and so took the man's fingerprints. Both the DNA and the palm print was an exact match. The police had found their killer, 33-year-old, jobless and homeless, Michael Wyatt. Michael Wyatt was originally from Jamaica and a repeat offender. He was charged with the murder of 11-year-old Wayne and appeared in court on the 10th of October 1990, where he was remanded into custody to await his trial. During Michael Wyatt's trial, it was revealed that he had killed a man back in Jamaica over an argument over cooking oil, and for this crime, Michael Wyatt was convicted of manslaughter and sentenced to 18 months in prison. After his release, he moved to England. On the 10th of August 1991, 18 months after the murder of 11-year-old Wayne Taylor, 32-year-old Michael Wyatt was found guilty of murder and also guilty of the attempted murder of the 9-year-old boy. 33 years after Wayne Taylor's murder, I could find no information of what happened to paedophile rapist Michael Wyatt or how long he was sentenced for. It is unknown whether he is still in prison today or if he has been released, and if he has been released, when he was released. And does he still live amongst us in the UK, or was he deported back to his country of birth, Jamaica? It has also been speculated that Michael Wyatt worked as a controller in a taxi rank on Atlantic Road in Brixton and that he was known to Wayne's family, meaning that he was no stranger to Wayne. So as Wayne was on that road that day, asking those he knew if they had seen his dad, he could have also went into the taxi office where the paedophile Michael worked to ask him if he had seen his dad, unaware of the terrible chain of events that lay ahead. Witnesses also report seeing Michael wearing the trapper hat around the area. Not a single newspaper, mainstream, local, or otherwise, reported on the trial. Neither did any news TV channel either. So there are many questions left about the trial that still remain to be answered.